Oh, hey, welcome back. Sorry, no time to teach. I just read that poisonous eels escaped from the zoo and are now swimming around in the sewers, attacking people in their restrooms. So naturally, I am packing my stuff and moving far, far away from here. Oh, see? Here's the article. You can read all about... Oh, people in the comments are saying it's fake. They're pointing out that there's no mention of eels on the zoo's website, and that the article was first written 7 years ago, and they even linked to a fact-checking site that debunks the story. Okay. Well, I guess if there are no eels in the sewers, I can stick around here for a little while. Honestly, I should have known better than to fall for that. By the end of this lesson, you will be able to evaluate whether the information you find online is trustworthy. That way, you won't look silly believing eels are going to pop out of your toilet. Let's get into it. The web is a fantastic, seemingly endless source of information. Anybody can say whatever they want on the web and then share it with others, which sounds great, except that not all information is true. Disinformation, a lie intentionally created and spread, is common on the internet. Dis, as in the opposite of, because deliberate lies are about as far from information as you can get. People who spread disinformation don't just find lying fun. They do it to deceive other people, to manipulate others into believing something, or simply to hurt other people. But I shared that post about the sewer eels earlier. All my friends and family saw it. Some of them even shared it to others after seeing it from me. Am I guilty of spreading disinformation? Nah. It wasn't on purpose. As soon as I realized it was false, I deleted it and informed the people I had shared it with. We've all spread incorrect information before without knowing it, even before the internet existed. The reason we specify that disinformation is intentionally created and spread is to separate it from misinformation, which is false information that gets created and spread completely on accident. It's not an attempt at deception or manipulation or sowing chaos among the masses. Somebody just shared information they thought was true, but it wasn't. Misinformation is more innocent than disinformation, but it's also much more common, and it can be just as troublesome when you're searching for information online. So, how can you tell fact from fiction? You can test if it's a trap, of course. The TRAAP test is a way to evaluate whether information is credible, or if you're in danger of falling into a misinformation trap by believing it, or worse, spreading it to others. The TRAAP test consists of 5 factors: timeliness, relevance, authority, accuracy, and purpose. Think of it kind of like rating the information source scale from 0 to 5. The more of these factors a source has, the higher its rating is, with the most credible information scoring a perfect 5 stars. The first factor is timeliness. To check for timeliness, first make sure that you are looking at the most up-to-date version of the information. You don't want something that might be outdated. This can be as easy as typing in some keywords into a search engine to find the most recent result. Once you've found the most up-to-date information, ask yourself, is your source recent enough to contain adequate information on the topic you are researching? There isn't a hard and fast rule here, because different topics can tolerate older sources better. An article from 1880 is fine if you're researching the most important inventions of the Industrial Revolution, but if you're researching medical treatments, an article from 1880 would probably recommend putting leeches on your body instead of going to the doctor for an x-ray. Whew. Choose information sources that are timely for the particular topic of research you're interested in. The next test is all about relevance. How much does the information relate to the topic you actually want to learn about? A failure in relevance could be as obvious as finding a spaghetti recipe when you were trying to learn how to make sushi, or as subtle and easy to miss as reading a book about World War I when you meant to learn about World War II. It's also important to compare the relevance of this source to that of other sources. A source with only a small bit of information that is relevant to your needs is okay, but a source that is chock full of relevant information is way better. You always want to go with information that is the most relevant, not just information that is technically relevant. The A in TRAAP, well, one of the A's, reminds you to check the authority of your source. Check who created or published the information. It could be a person, a company, an organization, or even a government. Once you know who the creator is, look into their background and find out whether they're qualified to be publishing information on this topic. A tropical ecologist is totally qualified to create an informative video about animals in the rainforest. A firefighter is probably not qualified to publish information about rainforest animals. Authority is all about whether you can trust the creator to know what they're talking about. One small disclaimer here. The authority test only checks whether there's good reason to believe the creator is an authoritative source of information, but it doesn't automatically guarantee that the information they've given is true or false. That tropical ecologist isn't perfect and could easily have made a mistake while reporting the facts. And just because a firefighter isn't an authoritative source doesn't mean anything they say about the rainforest is automatically wrong. Credibility is based on a lot more than just authority, which is why there's an entire TRAAP test, not just the A test. The second A in the TRAAP test stands for accuracy, or whether the information is sufficiently backed up. Hopefully, as you tested for timeliness, relevance, and authority, you've also noticed whether your source agrees on the major facts with other timely, relevant, and authoritative sources. A great way to do this is by looking on fact-checking sites. They'll tell you whether information is accurate, explain how they know, and link you to sources backing up their findings. Part of accuracy is also ensuring that the information in your source is presented in an unbiased manner, and that evidence is provided either within the source itself or in the sources that it cites. The goal here isn't to judge whether the information is true or false, but whether it is at least accurate enough to align with other seemingly credible sources. The final letter in TRAAP stands for purpose, as in, for what purpose was this information source created in the first place? Does it exist to teach you about something, to entertain you, to convince you that something is true, or to sell you something? Is the information presented as fact or opinion? And is that actually what it is? Sometimes the authors are completely transparent and openly admit to their intentions, but other times the purpose is hidden. So you might have to do some digging into the author or organization publishing the information, often at the same time that you're checking out their authority. For instance, a report identifying nuclear energy as the cleanest, safest, most environmentally friendly form of energy might seem super informative, especially if it includes a lot of graphs and data. And the author is none other than the owner of a nuclear power plant. Who could possibly be a more authoritative source on the subject? But that nuclear power plant makes more money if more people get their power from nuclear energy. So, are we sure this is just an informative report and not an attempt to deceive people into using nuclear energy more so the power plant makes more money? It might be worth looking into other sources that don't have a potential hidden agenda just to see if they agree with the report. You may have noticed something. A lot of these factors in TRAAP overlap with each other. When looking for the most timely information, you'll probably find yourself comparing information to determine accuracy. While investigating the creator's authority, you'll gain some insights into the purpose of the information. Because of all the overlap, you'll rarely be evaluating a single factor at a time. Luckily, there really isn't an order you have to do the TRAAP test in. What's important is that you carefully check each of the five factors so that you can get a good idea of whether the information is credible or whether you might be falling into a misinformation trap. Oh, that reminds me. If While deciding whether a source is credible, you find a different source that you like more, you'll have to start over and do the entire TRAAP test on the new source. That's just the cost of wanting to have the best information possible. At this point, we know how to find information sources, how to keep bias from hurting our search for information, and how to evaluate whether sources of information are credible enough to trust. There's only one thing left to do, the thing we wanted to do all along. Use the information we found. But those ideas and information sources are intellectual property that belongs to their creators, and we wouldn't want to steal their hard work. In the next lesson, you'll learn how to respect others' intellectual property and give credit where credit is due. Until then, remember, your brain is the smartest computer you'll ever have, so keep it charged and never stop updating it. See you next time. Hey, hey.